Thank you very much, Russell. Welcome everybody to this first webinar in what we hope might be a very good and engaging series of conversations. Our topic this evening is canon law education in the formation of priests. And as you can see, at least two of us obviously, but I know others on the panel are ordained. So this is something that actually impacts on our lives in more than one way. And it's great to have a variety of you attending, not only from your backgrounds and your ministry, but also from different parts of the world. As Russell said of himself, I'm a parish priest. I was until fairly recently an archdeacon, and I've been involved in education and training in a number of dioceses over the years. And I'm going to ask my fellow panelists if they would briefly introduce themselves and say just a little bit about themselves, and particularly what institutions and so on that they actually come from. So Andrew, if we could start with you.
Hi everybody, I'm Andrea Russell. I'm a tutor here at Queen's Foundation in Birmingham, but soon to be Director of Ministry in Oxford Diocese starting in the new year. I teach denominational studies and include within that sections on canon law. And to be honest, I try and squeeze canon law in, you know, as and when. Is that enough, Simon?
That's fine, yes, we'll go around. Stephen.
Hi, I'm Stephen. I'm a parish priest as well in the Church of Ireland in the Diocese of Dublin. I am the provincial and diocesan registrar here. I did the LLM in canon law a few years ago. And yeah, good place to start.
Thank you. And Helen.
I'm Helen Costigan. I'm not ordained. I'm a member of a Roman Catholic religious congregation called the Society of the Holy Child Jesus. And I teach canon law in the ecclesiastical faculty, which is part of St Mary's University in Twickenham, and I'm also involved in priestly formation.
Thank you all very much. Our panelists are very welcome, and we look forward to what you have to say. Now, our topic is very much about canon law, the law of the church, which guides and frames our life together as the body of Christ. We're very well aware that, of course, the church is subject of whatever denomination to wider laws than that, the laws of the land, in terms perhaps of health and safety or planning, if you want to build an extension to your church, all of that applies. And all of us at the moment are living with law and regulation, most unexpectedly coming from government with COVID-19. So law has become something that's actually really impacting on every one of us. But this afternoon, this evening, we're going to be concentrating very much on the law that frames the life of the church. And so the first question I want to ask you, panelists, is thinking about canon law, in what ways is it part of the life of your church as you experience it? How does it help frame and support, if you like, the mission and ministry of the church you're part of? And Steve, would you like to start from perhaps a slightly different aspect in the church in Ireland?
Well, in the Church of Ireland, to think about canon law is a game of two halves, because on the one hand, we love synods. We absolutely love them. We've had a general synod since disestablishment in 1869. I know the C of E is still a relative newcomer to this whole general synod lark. And our general synod is indecently large. We have 659 people on it, which actually means that as a proportion of the worshipping Anglican community, quite a lot of people are involved in the lawmaking processes of the church. So that's on the positive side. On the other hand, it may surprise you to learn that some people are left rather cold by canon law, and indeed in aspects of the life of the church. In particular, I would say in the court structure and the juridical side of things, it is somewhat underdeveloped and a bit neglected.
Thank you. Just to follow that up, would you say that the clergy and the leaders of your church feel that canon law has a very positive role within your church?
I would say there would be a mixed set of answers to that also. I think some people have done good work. People like the Bishop of Cork have been ploughing a furrow to try to get people to take it more seriously for some time now. And I think people realise in moments of crisis and difficulty its use and its benefits. I think in day-to-day life, it doesn't enter people's heads quite so much, but I don't think there's a desperately negative view of it either, but I think there's widespread and healthy apathy.
Thank you. Helen, let's hear from you how things look from the Roman Catholic point of view.
I think most ordinary lay people don't even know there is such a thing as canon law, and often are quite surprised by how interesting it can be. Every ordinand for the priesthood has to have exposure to canon law, so it's seen as being very important, and particularly in respect of ongoing formation. I suppose in making law, very few people are involved. That really comes out of Rome and consultation with bishops and so on. But most ordinary people really don't know about canon law, which is a pity, because I think it's the most fascinating subject. I would say that, wouldn't I?
Yes, I hope you would, yes. So, Andrea, from the point of view of your perspective within a training institution, what's the part of canon law in the life of the Church of England?
Just said tonight that Queen's Foundation is an ecumenical college that train people for Methodist and Anglican ministry. So it's interesting to be doing canon law alongside other denominations as well. And we have Centre for Black Theology as well. So I think Stephen's answer is probably indicative, Russell and Simon, for the Church of England as well. This sort of mixed reaction to canon law. I think for some people it's fascinating and interesting, and there's a whole structure about how we live together. For some people, they think it's irrelevant, or is just there if we make a mess, or is just there to restrain and restrict us. So I think, you know, Helen's comment would be echoed as well within Church of England circles, that many people don't even really know much about canon law, and I think that's both ordained and lay. There isn't a part of the curriculum that says for IME1, for the ordinands, that they have to know X, Y, Z. They do have to know about canon law, but it's up to us really what we put in there. So I think it's mixed.
Thank you. Can I just follow up with you, Andrea, because I know that your background is as a lawyer as well as a theologian, but I know that you also have a very particular passion for canon law in a theological context, rather than it just being law. Could you just say a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so this is my moment to mention Richard Hooker.
What a surprise.
For those of you who are listening on this who don't know who Richard Hooker is, go and find out. Fascinating. And yes, I was a solicitor originally, so law was my first degree, and have a passion to see how law has a theological underpinning. And I think that is the important bit of canon law, is the fact that this is about who we are as the body of Christ together. And that Hooker would want to say that law in various guises is actually, dare I say, is actually the way that God communicates to us. So I want to suggest that we might even glimpse the divine. That should start the chat going.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I would say, actually, from my work as an archdeacon until recently, that what everyone's expressed as the varied view of people you can see in parishes around. But actually, what's really helpful, perhaps, and this is the role maybe of an archdeacon, is to help people find ways of going forward and flourishing within the framework that's offered, rather than feel that it's the heavy hand or something that always wants to say no. I know people don't always experience it quite like that, but I think people can be helped to do that. And I think helping people to see what canon law is like and its potential really leads us on perhaps to the next topic, which is very much part of all your lives, which is to do with how do we teach it and share that understanding with people we come across in seminary, in theological college, in all kinds of courses. So I'm going to ask each of you perhaps just to say a little bit about how you actually teach and engage with people. And I think it would be very interesting from the point of view of our listeners, our participants, perhaps just say some of the techniques you think work well, because I can imagine that there are some people who find this not the most easy topic to embrace. So what works well and how do you go about it? Helen, could I start with you with where you do things and how you do it?
Okay, so the teaching for Roman Catholic ordinance is right across the seven books of the Code. Now, there is a major focus on the celebration of sacraments. Now, I'm told that in many continental universities, the standard mode of teaching is two-hour lectures. I much prefer a more active way of teaching so that I can stay awake and so can the students. And remembering that they're going to be going into pastoral work in a parish, I devise case studies and scenarios and role play as well, so they know how to deal with awkward parishioners or maybe an awkward priest. Let's not be, you know. You get both, you know. And to look at a number of issues relating to access to the sacraments or the spending of money in a parish or rights that seem to be being trampled on. So it's very much based on what's going to help them in their life as a priest. So a bit of lectures, but also testing to see what they've done and getting them to really think about how they would interact or explain to parishioners various aspects of the Code. But also I want to give them tools to interpret the canons. There are 1752 canons. We're not going to look at all of those in detail, but they need to be able to know what is the literary form of a canon. It could be theological, it could be exhortation, admonition, a directive, and so on. So they need to be able to look at that and to think about the canon in terms of its purpose, its sources, and how it can be applied. So I tend to be a bit more active and get them to do some of the explaining.
Thank you. And very interesting, your different kind of literary categorization of canons as well. I think that's a very useful tool to think about. Not all of them are exactly the same, are they? And they have different intents.
Very different, yeah.
And purpose. Yeah. And Andrew, would you like to pick that up? What are some of the things that you pick up on and how do you approach sharing canon law with students?
Well, I think, you know, many of us will be doing very similar things to Helen in that idea. I think one of the first challenges we have doing canon law at all is the fact of trying to get people to think this is both interesting and relevant. And so it's about trying to make those immediate connections to everyday church life. And I suppose the way that I go about this when I'm teaching ordinance is that idea of living as people of promise. So one of the questions that often comes up about canon law for us is the fact that there is no penalty. So if you breach canon law on a Sunday, there is no canon law police who's just going to pop in and tell you that you shouldn't have done that. Stephen, you cannot go and do that. He could. And therefore that raises questions about why we would want to keep some of these canons. So it's and so the way that I'm doing this is about thinking about community, and particularly in the formation of priests and deacons, I'm looking at the fact that canon law is about all of us together. So one of my key things is the fact that canon law says to us that it's not all about the ordained. And that seems to me to be really important. So yes, we use some scenarios, we use some discussions. I dare them to go off and talk to their incumbents, and really trying to remove both the fear of canon law and also the dryness of it a bit. And you'd have to ask my students, and I'm hoping there's none of them on the webinar, whether that's at all interesting.
Thank you. Could I just ask you to say a little bit about something I heard you talk about once, which is you said something to a group of students about the requirement to say the daily office, which is a canonical requirement. And you managed to turn that into something really quite different from what you might expect. Could you just say a little bit about that? Because I thought that was fascinating.
I've done that a few times and done that in some of the ELS ones that we've done as well. So taking something that talks about the fact that we should be doing, you know, the canon's slightly changed now, but what we should be doing morning and evening prayer, and I always tell them to go and ring a bell, and that's the fun bit. But if you have a church where you can't, you wouldn't be able to go to the church in the morning, it's too cold, nobody comes, then you need to discuss that with your PCC about where morning prayer will be held. And it may be that in that discussion you say, I'm going to be holding it at 8 o'clock in my study and I'm going to ring the bell. And then, you know, one of the people on the PCC says, well, actually, Vicar, I'm going to do the same. I'm going to pray at 8 o'clock. And, you know, and on a Friday, I meet with Ethel and perhaps we'll meet a bit earlier and we'll pray together at 8 o'clock. And then the next thing you know is they're asking you whether there are any special prayers that they could use. Well, who'd have thought it? And, you know, what Bible passages should we have? And suddenly the lectionary is out there. And actually, there's a way of seeing a lot of that PCC discussion and discussion with the wider congregation as missional. So from that one little canon that says, you hold morning prayer, suddenly prayer becomes the very centre of what you're doing as an ordained minister. And you are saying that you are doing this with and for and on behalf of others.
Thank you very much. That's really interesting. I think
making sure that the missional
aspect of the canons is really important. Stephen, could you just add your bit too about how you engage with the groups of people and what works for you?
Well, I'm quite fortunate in that I don't work with ordinance per se. I work with people who have been ordained deacon and are back in the institute for some time during their deacon year to finish a master's and do a few other bits and pieces. So by that stage, they've all been in the parish. They've had the difficult encounter. They've had the awkward question. They've had the incumbent asking them to do something they're not all that sure about. And so we go through the constitution, sources, important bits of civil law, but the majority of it, and this I stole blatantly from Will Adams' book, is the curate's answering machine. Some problem questions, this is on your phone, where do you find the answers, where do you start, how do you unpack it? And well, I would say normally they're quite keen for me to stop talking so they can say, well, look, actually, this is what happened to me and how do I work that out? But yeah, my problem question seems to work better than the dry lecture. But my lectures might be particularly dry.
I think we've all found that actually the scenario and the kind of case study does engage people and it brings out their experience too. And I think once you can ground things in people's experience, it begins to live for them rather than be abstract and rather more distanced. I think that's really, really very helpful. You all operate in slightly different ways, in slightly different parts of your church's life. I have to say, my experience of training as an ordinand was completely missing. Canon law was completely missing from that as far as I can recall. And I'm not sure my training incumbent was particularly acute about it either. And I guess like a lot of people, I bumped along getting quite close to disaster sometimes. And it wasn't until I personally felt I needed some guidance that I started looking for where it might be. So this is perhaps something, a topic we'll come back to later in our conversation. About where we might want to go to make it a better place for all. But thank you very much. Just a little bit then about perhaps the people who come to you and how you engage with them. I might start again with Stephen because he's talking to people who've been ordained. But the different attitudes that and you sometimes have to embrace or counter or work with when you actually say, well, there is a formal requirement here or there is a framework that we're given. You can't simply do just what seems right to you. How do you engage with that, Stephen?
It's not as prevalent as you might expect it's going to be, I find. I've had one session where one person took out a very large Bible and just spent their time flicking backwards and forwards through it, presumably finding verses to refute the errors I was peddling. I can't be quite sure. But most people are generally willing to come to the topic with an openness, perhaps thinking it's going to be a bit in the dull side, but certainly not thinking that it isn't relevant to them. And most people, I think once they see that actually canon law is there to facilitate the life and work of the church, it is there to help the church to be the church, and not there simply to say no and to quash all the excellent ideas they've had, they're a little bit more open to it. But I think we have a bad PR problem.
Yeah, I think you're probably right, yes. It's probably not the most exciting topic people think, but it really is about life. Andrea, I mean, I know you work with people in the first phase of their training up to ordination and also with those who are in the second phase, so post-ordination into curacy. How do you find different people respond, particularly once they've got a bit of experience under their belt?
I think that's when it changes a little. I mean, my sort of feeling is that in the first stages, it's about hearts and minds, I think, and trying to make those theological connections. I mean, I think when Stephen was talking, I wanted to say that the one of the PR problems we have is the fact that people think theologically law is bad and grace is good. And actually, it's trying to engage with the idea that that isn't the case. And that then seems to trickle down to the canon law stops us doing what we need to do. And it's all about grace. And so it then connects up, I think, with ecclesiology. How do we understand ourselves as being church? How do we understand the other? So I haven't really answered your question there, but I got overexcited. So I think that as they get into IME 2, if they've had some of that before, then it starts to be about the practical issues that many people are already finding and looking for support. And I think one of the things that we've found, Simon, as well, is being able to, and this has been great on the ALS days, being able to point to registrars and say they're there to help you. And they're there, not there to laugh at you or to say that you've made a mess, that actually there is again that idea of community and seeing ourselves as being part of the wider community as well. So health and safety and safeguarding are as missional as preaching the gospel. I think they are preaching the gospel. And so that's one of the things that we're trying to do, aren't we, Simon, with IME too?
Yeah. Yes, very much.
I think there's a theological undercurrent to some of the resistance sometimes.
Yeah, I think that can be. I'd like to come back on that in a minute, but before that, I'd go to Helen. How do you find that with the people you work with, the different responses to it?
Well, I suppose there is the initial perception that canon law is dull and boring, or that it tends to have a bad name, like the arteriosclerosis in the body of Christ, or the dark side of the good news, but they tend at the end to see it as freeing, liberating, even uplifting. And I suppose it's quite contemporary today because there are a number of real issues emerging, like the seal of the confessional, for example, should we have married priests in the Roman Catholic tradition, and all those kinds of things. So they can see that it's something that is dynamic and not static. It is evolving all the time, and that's where they get really quite excited, think, oh yeah, I get this, this is not as boring as I thought it was going to be. And some actually go on for further studies in canon law. So,
thank you. I think it's really important that actually people do see it as a dynamic and evolving thing. I mean, we're not living within the canons of the 18th century, are we? We're life has moved on, and the experience of the church has moved on. I'm very privileged still to be involved in having some canon law sessions with the curates in this Diocese of Lichfield, and Andrew and I partner on some of that. And I think what's very interesting there, just picking up something that Andrew was saying, is that some people perhaps feel that the legal framework of the church is a kind of dead weight to mission. And they can get very enthusiastic about what they want to do missionally, which is very laudable. And yet I sometimes feel a question in my mind about, if you're forging ahead like this, who are you not listening to? Who's not getting a voice in this conversation because you are passionate? And one of the things that I may not be entirely right about this, but I find useful about talking about canon law with people, is that it does actually allow for checks and balance and different voices and the place of laity and ordained within the decision-making structures. And you can misuse it, but it generally aims not to let anybody run off with things without due consideration and consultation. And since we are the body of Christ, not a group of sort of separate Christians, that seems to me to be particularly important. And I find that's something that church wardens get when we talk to them in their training about some of the canon law that operates around them, particularly things to do with faculties and so on, and permission to do things in buildings. So I think it is, we've touched on it a number of times, helping people see that this is a creative set of possibilities, but also something that might make you pause and think rather than just rush off. believing that you've been inspired and maybe doing a bit of harm along the way. Thank you for those. Now I want us to move perhaps a little bit more into the kind of the visionary. If you could, where would you place canon law and canon law education in the life of your church and in the formation of its ministers? How would you do that? And I'd like to start with Helen, if I could.
Okay, I do think that canon law is very much valued in the life of the Roman Catholic Church from the point of view of the training of ministers. If we look at the number of faculties across the world, you'll see that a lot of them teach canon law, and there's a number of lay people who go on to study canon law. Also, if you go to Rome, there's a number of departments there dealing with different aspects of canon law, and there are also a number of canon law societies throughout the world, so members can join that. I would like to see more in the way of ongoing formation for clergy and also formation for lay people. I went twice with a group of postgraduate students to visit various departments in Rome dealing with canonical issues, and that was a great experience, being able to talk to people on the ground who are dealing with canonical problems from the worldwide church. I think there is a great hunger, to be honest, from ordinary people who want to know a bit more. Particularly when I talk in parishes to people, they're absolutely amazed that they have rights in the church. Parish priests tend to get a wee bit nervous at that idea. But I think they find that really interesting. So I think a push for adult education and ongoing formation would be really important.
Thank you, Helen. I think it's something that needs to be developed. I'm hoping we might come on to how that might happen a little later. Stephen, where would you love to place this in the life formation of the ministers, the priests of your church?
I would take it slightly broader even than that. I think if we're going to have it taken seriously in the formation of clergy, it has to be taken more seriously at all levels of the church. I think one of the things, I mean, the gospel from Sunday was a gift, the power to bind and to loose, thinking about authority and structure and the power given by Christ to Peter and then broadened out to the disciples and arguably to the church. And I mean, my wife always counsels me against preaching about canon law, but actually, of those of us who are here or participants who do habitually preach, how often do we talk about the law of the church or the role of law in the church? If we think about things that canon law can do in the life of the church, its ecumenical potential, the interfaith potential of canon law as something that can connect people, these are all incredibly important and quite exciting things that law can do. I think, and I do this myself, I think when we speak to people and teach people about canon law, what we're doing is we're talking to them in part about how to put out fires. We give them a fire extinguisher and send them out as though that's adequate. And actually there's something much more exciting that is earlier. I mean, canon law is for life, not just for crises.
That's very good.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely. Yes. It should help us flourish, shouldn't it? And that's really important. Yeah. And Andrea, where would you ideally place this in the life of your church and its ministers?
I mean, I think I'm with Helen and Stephen. I think, you know, we've got the title here tonight about formation of priests, but unless it's actually about the whole understanding of Christian formation. And how do we live well as a community together and be accountable to each other? I mean, I think at the moment that our churches are rightly under scrutiny. And we need to show as part of our mission that actually we want to be accountable to each other. And it seems to me that canon law is a fabulous tool for that. And also, you know, one of the things that's happening to do with the growth of the church and thinking about the growth of ministry being not just about ordained ministry, the canons seem to me to already have much of that embedded. So you talked about church warden, Simon, you know, done some work on, I think the canons talk about being church warden as a vocation. So the vocation to be a priest is not the only vocation in the church. And actually, we can learn about vocation from that. And so that valuing of each other. And I think it's about, again, PCCs and the wider church body knowing that canon law is there. So the canon that says, you know, I had a student say to me, so we can, as Anglican priests now, we can wear what we like. And that, you know, for divine service, that is not what the canon says. The canon says you will discuss this with your PCC about what you will wear. And why do we do that? Not so that you can be a real, you know, stop you wearing a peacock feather. It's because this is about all of us. So when we stand there at the front on a Sunday, we're not there just for ourselves. And I'd like to see it valued throughout. So from the top right across.
Yeah. Thank you. I mean, I think we're drawing a really important point, important to me, and that is that both ordained and lay who have leadership roles in the church have responsibilities for others. And you don't just occupy those roles so that you can do what you want or bring about what you would like to see. It's a really important point about stewardship and how canon law allows you to be a good steward of the precious things that you're given. And one of those precious things is other people, some of whom you may get along with and others you may find difficult, but they're all part of that vocation of Christ to be part of the church. And equally, I mean, I think the point was made perhaps by Andrew that we are under scrutiny from outside. And in some ways, if we don't enact good regulation for ourselves, it's a temptation for others to do it for us. If we're going to be allowed to operate in the public square and speak into the life of the wider community, which is our calling. So some very important points there about being seen to be responsible and good stewards of what we have. I say that with trepidation as the chair of my DAC. So deciding on faculties.
Can I just say, I think it's in the chat, and I think you keep picking this up for us, that actually law sounds as if it's top-down power, yeah. But actually used well, this should be quite the opposite.
Yes.
And I think, you know, that's what Stephen and Helen and I have been trying.
Absolutely.
To.
And I think things are handed to us at different stages in ministry, both lay and ordained, and actually using them well is not always easy. And so having any resource that helps us in that way is worth having. But of course, if you don't know what's there, then you've got a real problem. So that kind of leads me to ask you another question, really. Given the fact that there are different stages of development, both for lay ministry and ordained ministry, though we're primarily talking about formation of priests, different stages, we're struggling quite a lot, I think, and I've seen it in the chat already. What would go into a useful curriculum at what point? I mean, what do you think people should really know about at different points? And it'd be just interesting to draw on your experience, because at the moment, from what most people seem to be saying, they either themselves didn't experience much in training if they were ordained, or they don't feel there's very much very firmly in the required curriculum, certainly not perhaps from those who are talking from a Church of England point of view. That may be rather different from the church in Rome. But so what would you want to make sure that people had before they stepped out, if you see what I mean, or took the mantle of responsibility? Helen, can we start with you on that one?
I would, as I mentioned already, ordinands are taught right across the range of subjects in canon law, but I would love to take them to Rome for a canon law tour and take them to the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith and meet the people who are working there. And there's no thumb screws, no rack, anything like that. They're just people trying to do the best they can. For lay people, I would want to do something about what canon law means for you in terms of their work within the parish, the sacraments, the relationship of the parish to the diocese, which is often neglected. In terms of ongoing formation for priests, marriage is becoming a very complex, complicated subject. So I think there should be more on that. And also talking about to lay people about how they are already being invited to be involved in things in the code. And not many people know about that. And also then, as a member of a religious congregation, I deal with a lot of issues there. And I think there has to be something on rights and responsibilities and good governance. So if you like, it's a multi-pronged approach.
Mm. Thank you. That's really helpful. Stephen, what about you? What would you want people to know and engage with before they were kind of let loose, really?
I think the most important thing I ever say to people is, if in doubt, ask. And I think if they go away with nothing else, I'm thrilled if they go away with that. Slightly broader than that, I think any good theology course really ought to have some appreciation of ecclesiology. And I think ecclesiology needs to have an appreciation of the law that underpins the church. Mm. And you can flip that on its head and say that really any good study of canon law has to have ecclesiology in it and has to have a good amount of theology in it as well, because we're not going to come away with much of a sense of anything beyond I've learnt the following list of rules if we don't know what underpins it. And you have to go back, you start in scripture, God creating by his word and saying in it is so, that's really where you start on a journey like this. And I know the idea of sort of ecclesiastical jurisprudence is enough to bring anyone out in a cold sweat, but we do have to be looking more at the ethos behind the regulation to actually try to enthuse people as well. So I would say a good dose of theology in there as well, which might actually be a pleasant surprise to some people slightly fearful that what they're going to get are the dry bones.
Mm, thank you. So Stephen, would you say that good canon law is an expression of good theology?
I mean, I don't think you could have good canon law that wasn't an expression of good theology. And this is something I loved on the LLM about looking at the Western Code and the Eastern Code. But certainly when we were going through that, I think the Catholic Church does a much better job than some Anglican canons I've read at actually taking the theological underpinning for a rule and making that obvious in the written law. I think maybe it's because we come from a common law tradition. Normally we just write out the regulation. You get the regulation, you don't really need to know the thinking behind it. And we're impoverished because of that. So I think there is a merit in actually trying to connect those two things together.
Mm, thank you. And Andrea, what would you want to equip people with before they took on responsibility? If in an ideal world, what would you give them? Apart from, of course, Richard Hooker in their top pocket.
There's no, I just don't understand the problem. I want to totally agree with Helen and Stephen, and that makes me think actually that we need to be doing more of this teaching together. That actually we need to do. You know, Stephen talked earlier about the ecumenical conversations that can come from this, the doors that can be opened, the interfaith. And I think the question would be, if the canons are preventing us doing that, so if they are complex, in our reading group last night, Russell, we were looking at B43 for the LEPs and so on, and some of that is really, really complex. And then you want to start asking some questions about that. About who this is for, but I'd be starting off with Stephen. You know, broad theological horizons, something about the fact of living well together, and using the minutiae, if you like, to support some of that, and keep bringing home the fact that this is not just about the ordained.
Thank you. There's something that's been mentioned along the way, really, which is about canon law being part of a living tradition because it's part of a living church. And also, it's been mentioned in the chat, I've just been keeping my eye on, that actually for some people, there's a sense of being constricted in the way we do fresh expressions and try to move forward. There's been a lot of challenge, really, due to COVID-19 and the restrictions on the church to do church in different ways. So bearing in mind that people will be listening in, what would you want to change if you could in the current canons? Well, I mean, you might not want to be specific, but just a general area. Is there something you'd want to free up or look at again, thinking that actually is perhaps a bit of the past that we no longer need to live with? I don't know. Andrea, I'll start with you this time. We'll go around the other way because I'm sure you're up for that one.
You didn't prime us on this question.
It's kind of arisen out of the conversation. Go on.
What would I want to change in the existing
category? Yeah.
Well, I would like to. I mean, I know we've only just changed people to three, so I feel really bad saying this, but I do think it needs a bit more tidying. So this is the one that deals with our local ecumenical partnerships and also what we can do in and out of each other's churches. I don't know. I teach this alongside the 13 articles, alongside professional guidelines. So interestingly, I think about all these ideas about loyalty and obedience and accountability and stuff together. And actually, just some of the language sometimes I find really off-putting in all of those, that actually there just comes a point where the male language and the particular implicit powers within it become quite difficult. So I basically sometimes want to rewrite the whole lot, which might not be what you want to hear from me, Simon.
So yeah, that's fine. I mean, I think if it's a living tradition, we need to hear those parts of the conversation. Helen, where would you want to perhaps sort of lay an axe to the root of something?
No, I wouldn't chop anything down, but I would want to promote what is already in the Code of Canon Law, the emphasis on baptism, which is the sacrament of incorporation. So all Christ faithful are members of the church by virtue of baptism. And it makes it very clear, you know, before there is any division into clergy and lay people. And I think during COVID, we've certainly seen that in practical action, the way that people have risen to the challenge, whether they articulate it or not as living out their baptism, they've certainly done that in so many different ways. So I would want to really emphasise that aspect, that you're living out the baptismal covenant, which is what a lot of people have done during COVID-19. It's very edifying.
Thank you. Stephen, what would you try and make a difference?
I'm sorry to say the Irish canons are simply perfect as they are.
Of course.
What I would love to see is proper synodical reform. In particular, I'd like to see the General Synod be smaller than the House of Commons. There was some process of synodical reform started a couple of years ago, but I think to take what we did then and to try to implement it with having COVID in the middle and not changed anything because of COVID, I think really a sort of post-COVID scan through the canons to see that actually, I think, as Helen was suggesting, it will throw up more things than we might imagine. Yeah. So I think we won't know what those things are yet for some time, but certainly I'd like to see synodical reform.
Very interesting. Thank you. If I can just add a bit, I think one thing I would want to change is not necessarily anything specific about canon law or the ecclesiastical laws. It's really about who has responsibility under any of them, because I think all of us are experiencing a real change in church and a change in the age profile and the numbers of people who can take responsibility. And my fear is that some of the things that we think are simplifying things are actually putting more burden on less people. And I'm not quite sure where that leads us, because we don't want to let go of some of the checks and balances that we have. But I'm very, very, very conscious of the fact that some people are very burdened by helping us through the due process, and they may only be part of a handful in a small church trying to make their way, and maybe we need to think about how we operate as a church as a whole in slightly different ways. So for me, it's rather more about the people actually on who have to live with this and enact it, perhaps, rather than simply the law itself. I don't know if anyone wants to make a comment on that. Well, I think I'd just like to sort of to round off here, and perhaps we'll move to some questions, Russell, in a moment or two. We've given a good look around the way canon law is taught and experienced from our own particular points of view, and I think we've quite rightly broadened it beyond the formation of priests, because priests are the servants of the church, and the church is lay and ordained, and is wonderfully mixed, and that's great. We've mentioned the importance of theology and how good canon law arises out of good theology and ecclesiology. And we've also very much touched upon our sense that people really get into this when it meets them where their experience is and where their hearts can be fired up and impassioned for the mission that they feel this might enable them to do. The curriculum question is one that kind of hangs over all of this and where it's to be seen and how it's to be brought in different institutions. And it may interest all our participants to know that we have a subcommittee working in the Ecclesiastical Law Society to draw together information from a wide range about what curriculum there is and what curriculum we could recommend for different stages. And I think a lot of us hope that that's going to be really quite specific in terms of saying it would be good for people to have some understanding of this here and of that then and so on through time. I also hope it will be broader than simply those who are being ordained, but actually work through all the roles and offices that there are in our churches, which are becoming more and more required and more needed. So, Russell, do you want to say anything about this this curriculum work that we're undertaking in the ELS and where it might be?
Well, I think it ties in very much with the discussion. We've been having great discussion in the chat, while the equally excellent discussion on the video has been happening. A lot of interest in resources from the ELS. And I think you're right, Simon, that the curriculum that the Society is working on is really going to plug this gap and hopefully be a really helpful resource. And everybody who's attending this webinar, when the curriculum is published, we will email to let people know, and hopefully that will continue. And that ties in as well with the first question, the one that's been voted to the top from Simon Fisher. So hopefully Simon will be able to speak in a moment and be able to ask that question.
Hello, Russell.
Hi, Simon.
Right. Thank you, panel, for this. And yeah, it does tie into that question of the curriculum. I'm an archdeacon, and we are looking at how we improve the education, particularly in IME 4 to 7, about ecclesiastical law. So my question is, what are your top tips as to what bits of ecclesiastical law new clergy particularly should be familiar with? I've got my top two or three, but I wondered what yours were.
Well, it's a very good question. Stephen, can I start with you? What would your top two or three be that you would expect clergy to engage with? And have you got a resource you could point to that might help with that?
There's very little written in the Irish context. If they really want to get into something, Paul Coulton's PhD on sources in the Irish context is quite good. I would say, with all deference to our learned chairman, we could direct them towards his published works, some of the Norman Doe things. If people are recently ordained, I think Will Adams' book on canon law for the newly ordained or recently ordained is actually an excellent starting point.
Mm. Helen, what resources would you point to, and what things would you want people to start with, really?
Where would I start? Well, certainly the Ecclesiastical Law Journal is good. There is the Canon Law Society of Great Britain and Ireland newsletter. There are periodicals that are coming out, The Jurist and Studia Canonica from America and Canada. So I think they would be the main ones that would in English. There's loads of stuff in Italian and so on, but those are the ones I think. Certainly, Canon Law Society of Great Britain and Ireland is very useful, and the Ecclesiastical Law Journal. I would say that, wouldn't I? Because I've got an article coming out in that.
Well, good. Yeah. But it's good. It's good stuff. Yeah. And Andrea, what resources would you point people to?
I want to add particularly to those. I think that one of the most important bits is just to get people to read the primary text. Choose a couple of canons and just sit round and talk about them, actually. And then you sort of start to get a bit less fearful about reading them and handling them, I think. And obviously, read anything on Richard Hooker.
Yes, of course. If I can just add, I think probably from my experience as an archdeacon, the one resource that I insisted, if I could possibly insist, that every parish actually had was the church representation rules, which is actually how we govern ourselves in PCCs and in deanery synods and so on. But it's about, you know, who is there to give a voice and what kind of a voice. And I was constantly surprised at the number of clergy, both new and old, who really carried on their church council business, annual meetings, and without any reference at all to the church representation rules. And that meant that incremental difference over the years had meant you could end up with some quite extraordinary practices and behaviours. And it was considered to be kind of normal, but people generally reckoned it couldn't possibly have been right, but didn't know where to go to find a correction. So I think something as simple as that, which is now available online, is something I would recommend as an absolutely key resource. Russell, can we bring you in? I mean, what would be your key resource?
Well, I think I agree with what everyone said, that Stephen mentioned Mark Hill's books, and this is a really good summary of the ecclesiastical law.
You do realise that Mark is cheering now, we just can't see
Is he really? There may be just the final one or two in existence paperback versions or unsold in existence on the ELS website, but it's about to sell out. But what you said, Simon, about the church representation rules ties in very nicely with the next question that I hope David Lamming is going to ask.
Welcome, David. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Perhaps I ought to start by declaring an interest that I served on the revision committee for the measure that produced the current set of rules that came into effect on the 1st of January this year. My question is, are we including all aspects of ecclesiastical law under the umbrella title canon law? I mean, for example, do ordinands receive instruction on the CRRs as they relate to PCCs and the synodical structure of the Church of England? And of course, the rights of the laity under those rules.
Well, that's a very good question. I'm going to start with Andrew, but we can also broaden that out and find out whether priests' information in other parts of the church, with our panelists represent, whether they get an induction into how governance works as well. So, Andrew, specifically on the Church of England and your experience of education and training.
Well, in some places, no, they wouldn't hear anything about. It would probably just be a half a day right at the end of the IME1 on church law more generally. There's no requirement that they would know about the church representation rules. And in an increasingly packed curriculum, it's very difficult to know what to include. So often you're including things where you're just putting pointers to things, but we certainly wouldn't be going through the church representation rules in any sort of detail.
Yeah.
But we tend to leave that to IME2. The issue is, of course, that there's no common idea about what is happening in all IME1 or all IME2s. And I know we've got some in both tutors in both of those with us at the moment. So I don't think there's Simon, you and I both know that when we start teaching on IME2, you have to start off assuming that those in front of us have got nothing or very little. And that's often how it goes. I mean, I'm going to be taking over continuing ministerial development. And I think that's really important as well, because I think a lot of incumbents feel, somebody said, what is IME1? So IME1 is the ordination training route. IME2 is for curates in the church. But I think as well, we find it, Simon, that sometimes incumbents are embarrassed that they've lost their way a bit in some of this. You know, again, their lives aren't always easy. And so we need to try and make this as embedded as we possibly can. David, I didn't really answer your question, but to say, I think probably it was no. I can't remember what you asked me.
Stephen, can you pick this up? I think are we including all Ireland, aspects, and where does this come in?
Yeah, in Ireland, ordinands do get a session on the structures of the church and the representational structures of the church from someone who's in the synod department of the representative church body, because these are the things that quite often people do come up against and have difficulties with. And increasingly, I mean, here every parish is well underway becoming a registered charity, and we add charitable trustee duties to our select vestry duties and such like. And people are starting to realize that they have to take these things seriously. And I know as a registrar, a good proportion of the questions I get from clergy are on how to go about structuring these sorts of things. What happens if something's gone a little bit awry? Can it be fixed? You know, these are things that come up every day.
Thank you. Helen, what about you in terms of inducting people into the organisation structure and decision making?
Yeah, we do look at the question of governance and from the Pope, the role of the bishops, parish priests, and so on, and also have a look at the book 5 on temporal goods, which is one of the shortest books, but deals with money and stuff like that. So they do need to have an idea for that. But I say to them that you're not meant to be accountants or surveyors. So if you don't know, get help. And if you don't know, really know the canons, ask. Don't make up to go along. But certainly they get an overall idea of governance and those structures. Yeah.
David, I think we've kind of only picked up on one bit of your question. I think in the conversation we've been having, I've kind of been assuming that when we're talking about canon law, we're talking about the broad breadth of law and regulation as it applies to the body of the church, wherever we find it. And some churches may experience that more as canon, and others have more of a blended set of rules and regulations. Maybe one of the problems is actually the complexity of it. I mean, in the Church of England, we have all kinds of labels for the things that give legal right and responsibility, and it's not always easy to see where they are. I noticed that a comment that's been made in the chat, which is kind of worth perhaps reiterating, is that we do, and I don't know if this applies to in the Roman Catholic Church as much, but certainly in the Church of England, we place a huge reliance on training incumbents to share their knowledge and their understanding with curates. And perhaps in the past, when everybody was stipendiary, that was a particular set of people. Now, of course, people are training non-stipendary and other clergy in different categories, all of whom may well end up having some lead responsibility for some aspect of the church's life. And that kind of ups the ante, really, on making sure that people are able to practice well and be good. For my money, as an ex-director of ministry, I would say I think we need to invest more in training incumbents and equipping them, not for quality assurance necessarily, but so they feel confident to share and to guide those who are in their charge. And I think we probably invest rather less in training incumbents than perhaps we ought to, at least in this aspect. And that's my kind of fourpenneth. David, I'm not sure if we've given your question all the serious attention it might deserve, but you've certainly stimulated a bit of conversation there. Did you want to come back to us at all, if you're still on?
Yes, if I'm still unmuted.
You are?
Yes, I think I really wanted to emphasise the point that so far as the C of E is concerned, we are talking about ecclesiastical law, hence, of course, the title of Mark Hill's book.
Yeah.
So important law on safeguarding, on the clergy discipline measure and all the controversy that relates to that, all really relates to the law which one would expect that clergy in particular would have some basic knowledge of, even if they don't know all the detail. And certainly know where to find the law or who to ask about it if they came up upon a particular problem.
Yes. Yes. I mean, one of the issues, I think, for the Church of England, and maybe the Church of Rome is rather better blessed, and maybe the Church in Ireland too, is that there is no one-stop place you can go and find all the ecclesiastical law. There's no one website which brings it all together. If you look on the Ecclesiastical Law Society's website, we've done our best to try and draw together a document which gives you links to wherever you might find quite a lot of them. It's worth having a look at. It's part of the public pages. And that can at least help you find some of the important things. But of course, it's a bit of a game to make sure those links are live all the time. But you're welcome to have a look, everybody. Russell, do we have another question?
Well, the next question was asked by Raymond Corbett, who, as far as I can see, has had to leave. So perhaps if I read it out, he asked, could the panelists talk about the relationship between canon law and theology? It seems to me that that relationship is key in determining how canon law is integrated into formation for ministry or ordination.
Right. Okay. Stephen, would you like to pick up a bit on theology and law? How would you approach that a little bit?
I think it's the sort of thing that actually sometimes these two disciplines that really ought to talk to each other quite a lot don't necessarily get that opportunity. And you know, a certain interdisciplinarity is coming into the field of canon law now, and that's a very, very good thing. And we see it also more broadly in the study of ecclesiastical law and religion generally. If you take someone like Rowan Williams, who when he's talked about the structure of the church, will talk about the place of the cross within the life of the church as being a very foundational image, and we order ourselves in relation to that, and we end up being held judging our actions and judging our decision making over and against the reality of the cross at in our midst. And so as we try to do that, we are held in tension with other people around us also in the church, and all of us come to be held under authority as against the cross. So I think you have to have some of those conversations. You may find other ways of trying to structure and reason that out and explain it, but I think certainly that needs to happen. I think it's something that I haven't thought about enough in either when I studied theology or when I studied law, is actually trying to meld the two together, which is perhaps a project for another day. But I think certainly from the conversation we've had previously in this and what everyone has said across the board, I think it's pushing an open door.
Yeah, thank you. Helen, what particular theological insights would inform your approach to law within the church?
Well, I think theology underpins canon law, and I think I mentioned different literary genre in the code in particular. There are a number of theological statements before you get onto the canon law. Now, some canon lawyers don't like it and say, well, that's theology, it's not law. And I think, well, you're missing the point, actually. So, you know, when you get an introduction to the sacraments, for example, it will be a theological statement from which the canons then flow. So I see very much canon law is intertwined with theology.
Mm, thank you. And Andrea?
Yeah, all of that. And I think this whole idea about law, grace, justice, mercy seems to me to be really key. I think we couldn't say there's just one understanding of church. And in some ways, the canons offer for us different ways of approaching who we are, and particularly different ways of understanding ordination or what it means to be the body of Christ. And I think, you know, I'd like to see the canons being used as a Lent course. I've sort of said this before, you know, as a, and also 39 articles, but then, you know, it's not been produced as a Lent book. But I think these, I think what happens in class is often that we start to uncover some of the implicit theology that is behind some of our reactions to some of the either the canons themselves or the wider law. So, and then we find that perhaps, you know, we may not be quite as Church of England as we thought we were. You know, we try and tease that out. It just seems to me that it brings things to the surface when we discuss it well. So I'm not trying to say that church law needs to define for us definitely how we have to be, and nobody can decide otherwise. I'm saying I think it's a tool to help us to understand our own vision of God, actually.
Yeah. It's about having a broad conversation, isn't it? And I understand that the pressure that there is on any formal training program to make a curriculum and to categorize things and deal under subject headings. But once you start talking about this, you're really into some quite deep theology about the nature of God and the nature of Christ and atonement and redemption. And before long, you'll talk about doctrine as well as church history, and that the two are intertwined. And then out of that arises the question, so how shall we live together? And that seems to be the question at the heart of a lot of ecclesiastical law. You know, how shall we live together as the body of Christ, redeemed and working in the world? And to some extent, we perhaps need to engage with this in the broadest possible conversation, and see it as different aspects of the same thing, because it's all about our life, and indeed any topic which we might care to talk about in that sense is, and they're all interconnected. Russell, perhaps we've got time for one last question, and we'll see where that takes us.
Yes, well, the next one on the list is a question from Doug Chaplin. Are you there, Doug?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yep, we can.
My question almost starts where Simon's comments just ended, which is most people's encounter with ecclesiastical law, and in fact with law generally, come from either personal experience or hearing other people's stories of where things have gone wrong. And how does that perception change from law as something that's there to deal with problems to it as an expression of what it means to belong to a shared society and live out the values of that society?
Yes, I mean, so law, not just as remedy for something, but actually, if you like, invitation to share and be part of something. Yeah. Andrea, do you want to pick that up?
Yeah. Hi, Doug.
Hi, Andrea.
I think that idea of law as remedy, though, so I also want to talk about that as being grace. So it's okay that law comes in and acts as... and acts as something to help us to put us back together again. And I feel that says to those who are training for priesthood, you don't have to get everything right. I mean, let's hope that it's not too catastrophic when you get it wrong. Failure is just, and sin are just part of how we are together. So there is something about that acknowledgement that we aren't perfect. But I think you're right, that wider idea of, and Simon just said it, I think this is all about the living world together. And that means that I feel that as part of the curriculum in any part, it's got to not just be an internal conversation, but actually it's got to be keep picking up wider people.
Mm. Stephen, going beyond Laura's remedy to something else, how would you engage with that?
I think the very lucky and fortunate thing is the law already is something much broader than that. And I think we see this in the life of the church quite often, and it is there to spot if you know what you're looking for, but maybe it doesn't get spotted very often. A committee looking at the canons here in the 70s, they talked about canon law as being a handmaid to the gospel. And I think there's something quite nice in that image. And I think really part of this is actually trying to change the narrative around canon law. And I spoke earlier about what we say in our preaching. And I think even in formal settings of the church, like worship, but beyond that, and things like synods, general synods, deanery synods, to talk about law in a new way. I mean, one of the things that struck me quite a lot in recent years was when Pope Francis talked about a synod as not being a parliament, but as being a place to listen to the voice of the Spirit. Now, I've been to quite a few synods, and I think if I'd done a straw poll, that would not have come out on top if people were asked what it was they were there to do. So I think we do need to change the culture of law in the church, but it is something that is possible to do. But I would agree with Andrea that actually law's remedy is not failure. Law's remedy is God-given also, but the remit is broader.
Thank you. Helen?
I think the importance of law should be emphasised, and that people should understand that it's something that liberates and can inspires. And I agree with Andrea that law is remedy. A lot of the cases I've dealt with have arisen because people have been very hurt because of the misinterpretation of law or the way they've been treated.
Yes.
And through no fault of their own. And so law has been a remedy, and that's brought justice. I'm not certain that it's always brought healing. I think we need to re-emphasise the importance of knowing law if you're in a position of authority or service.
Yeah. Thank you. I mean, you touch upon something which would actually perhaps be the basis of a much bigger and wider conversation, which is that perhaps all of our churches have experienced in recent years, quite understandably, law and regulation as being something to prevent and to act against. And we need to hear that and take that on board. But if it is only about that, then it can mean that people who want to live good lives and actually be fruitful in their discipleship will think law is about actually the bad people and people getting it wrong and not about a means of flourishing in the everyday. And perhaps we've got a real challenge actually to make them in the framework of our life positive as well as remedy and bringer of justice and reconciliation. Yeah. Thank you. I think probably we've come usefully to the end of our time. And I'd like to thank very much my panellists, Helen, Andrea, and Stephen, and Russell for organising and being the eminence grise behind the whole event and making sure that we were able to be together. And thank you to all of you who've been part of this and who put some very interesting things on chat and asked some very interesting questions. And I hope you've found this profitable and useful, and it's got you thinking. And do look out for whatever we do next in this series, and do explore the Ecclesiastical Law Society's website, where you will find all sorts of hidden wonders and treasures. So thank you all very much indeed. Russell, do you want to say a final word before we go about maybe what's going to be available afterwards in terms of recording or list of resources?
Post, assuming the recording's worked, I'll post a recording of this to YouTube, and in response to a point in the chat, I'll try and write out some of the sources that people have referred to with links, if I can, and won't be keeping people's email addresses generally, of course, but I will keep them for one final email when our curriculum is published, as I think everybody participating in this webinar will probably feel it's worth an email to get a link to that. So I'll do that to be back in touch. And as I said at the beginning, for those who aren't members, it's been great to have you, and I hope some will consider joining the society.
Thank you all, and thank you all, everybody, and good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.